name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Indeed, allow me to say that it's so sweet to trust. You know, sometimes we sing these songs. It has just become maybe just a trail or custom for us just to see, but we don't seem to make to understand. What does this song say? You know, the last stanza that I like about this song. And that's why I don't know if the believers can show it, that what waves this song they're talking about. It is the SDA hymn that says, I'm so glad I learned to trust thee. This is somebody who is sharing an experience. He is talking to Jesus.
No, Jesus Christ.
That I am so glad I learned to trust
him.
Meaning that of all other things that this person has come into contact with, there's one thing that is appreciating or she's appreciating. And that is to trust in Jesus. Precious Jesus, Savior, meaning that he is the Redeemer. Again, there's a word that he used to frame, meaning that I can relate to Jesus as a friend. And I know that thou art with me. Not only now. It says, will be with me till the end. This person can go to sleep. Because the way has been guaranteed. And this is why I like this song, friends. And sometimes I listen to it many times. And then my personal experiences, when I relate to this song, I come to agree with the writer and the composer of this song. Friends, we are here this morning, this Sabbath. We have left everything that has been troubling us. And I want you to agree with me that the weeks, these times, they're just running like this. You know, it was like mine was just the other day. And then all of a sudden the week is finished and we are here. Tomorrow we are starting another week. And it will just go like that. But one thing that is for sure, friends, when the week has passed and it is gone, it is gone for good. Never ever to come back into this life history. So what you and I did not accomplish during that week, it means we have missed out. You know, I can see Pastor Banda here. And traditionally in our church as Adventists, that when there's a pastor in the midst, then the elder is not supposed to bear the puppet. And I was looking, I also saw my man also walking in. And then I was saying, whatever I'm going to preach, she'll be whispering tonight to Pastor Mark. She is going to evaluate to my sermon. And it brought some sort of fear in me. I'm sure preachers have stood here. They see at the door whoever is coming in, they keep counting. You start now scaling up your sermon to say, now look, this one has come in and he's going to do that. I just have a very simple message for you this morning. It is a blessing to have the person who I meet. It's a blessing to have the pastor's wife who I meet. It's also a blessing to have all the visitors of God. What do you say, church? My friends, I want us to look at the book of Daniel, chapter 1. You know the initiative that Odamante was in, announcing, revived by his
word.
Every Sabbath we are announcing that the word of God is being read worldwide by all the
nations.
And this morning we are reading Hosea chapter 11. And everybody is reading the word of God. And it is through this period that I have started discovering a lot of things that I didn't understand. And it has brought so much incredible discovery to the extent that everything that I find, I want to share with my church. But I am sure that most of these things that all of us, we are aware of
about.
We have read about the book of Daniel. We understand a lot of things the Bible is trying to make. But when you look back and sit and analyze the verses that you were reading, and find appreciation in the word of God. And I'm reading from the book of Daniel, chapter 1. Now, I want for those who don't know this, the book, it is a book that actually, as Adventists, as a church, and for every Christian, it's a very important book. It's a prophetic book. And if you can read and understand the book of Daniel, you can see that where this world is going and where the end is going to come. You understand the plan of redemption that God put before his people that
this world.
And then you would even know how do you navigate in the life
issue.
Now the book starts by describing and giving us a picture of children of Israel, or the children of God, those who are in captivity from Judah to Babylon. And I'm reading from verse 1. It says, in the third year of the reign of Joachim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord delivered Joachim, king of Judah, into his hand, along with some of the articles from the temple of God. These he carried off to the temple of his God with a small g in Babylon and put in the treasure house of his God against small g. Verse 3 says, then the king ordered Aspenaz, chief of his court officials, to bring into the king's service some of the Israelites from the royal family and the nobility. Verse 4, young men without any physical defect, handsome, showing aptitude for every kind of learning, well informed, quick to understand, and qualified to serve in the king's palace. He was to teach them the language and the literature of Babylonians. Verse 5, the king assigned them a daily amount of food and wine from the king's table. They were to be trained for 3 years, and after that, they were to be entered into the king's service.
Omnyaka wesithathu wobukumkani bukaYehoyada, king ubukumkani bukaYehoyada, kweza uNebukadnezara ubukumkani baseBhabhele eJerusalema wayigqiba. Inkosi yamnikela uYehoyada, king ubukumkani bukaYehoyada esandleni sakhe, ngenxa lenye yempahla zendlu kaThixo awazi ukubalela ezweni laseShinare endlini yothixo wakhe impahla ezo wazingenisa endlini yokungcwaba kothixo wakhe wathi kumkani kashkenazi umthetheli wathana wakhe babazise abakonyana bakaisrayeli nabembewu yakokumkani nabakumawaba abantwana abangenasiphako abanomkhithi ababuqiqileyo kulumko konke abanokwazi abanokuqonda bayazi into abafanele ukuma ebhotweni lokumkani abafundise incwadi nolwimi lwabakhaleti ukumkani wawamisela umamkelisi wemini nangemini yawo ekudleni kokumkani nasewayinini ayiselayo ukuze ngodliwe iminyaka emithathu bathi ekupheleni kwayo beme phambi kokumkani.
Now, friends, I just want to pause there. We are going to continue to read this. The king is asking something that one may think that is impossible. He's asking about these young men who are noble, those who are purely thinking, those who are able, who should
diligence.
And I was asking myself, how on earth did the king think that there would be such young people, those who find all these qualities? And among these children of Israel, the Bible tells us that those who are carried into captivity to start that 70 years of captivity, where some young men, those who are true Christians, the men who were as true as steel to principle, those who were not ready to be corrupt, but those who dared that they would only
honor
God. That despite whatever loss that may come before me, and that I would stand for the truth and
love.
Now the Bible goes on to say this in verse 6. And among those who were chosen, we are some from Judah. Now these were the Hebrew young men. And the Bible tells us that Daniel, number one,
Daniel,
Ananias, number two,
Ananias,
Mishael, number three, and Azariah, number four. And these were the four Hebrew boys. The official that the king had given this instruction. He looked around and he had no excuse. Now, something tells me, friends, that the reason that these look so appealing is because they showed that nobility, they showed that they had principles, that they had honored the laws and principles of elder health and also spiritual health. And that when this opportunity came, it is an opportunity that you cannot miss. In our days today, we say these were being given a scholarship. Where everything stands for. All your finances, all your food requirements, and your accommodation, everything paid by the king. And the Bible tells us they were chosen. And verse 7 says, because there was a motive, and the king had wanted these young men to serve him according to the way he wanted. They were given new names. Now I just want you to imagine, friends. You have been captured and you are going to Stephanie. You are going to a far foreign land. And you are slaves there in captivity. And then you are being subjected to all sorts of things. And now the question that you ask, what room do you have for you to compromise? When there is no hope for you, there is no hope where you are. And there is this opportunity that the scholarship is being
given.
If there's never been a test in your life, friends, for these four Hebrew young men, this was the challenge that they faced. Now, in the land of their captivity, these men, they knew in their hearts they were to carry out God's purpose by showing the heathen nation the blessing that comes through from the knowledge of Jehovah. That we want to show you, but that the God that we worship is the true Jehovah, and that when you honor Him, He gives you blessing. And when you honor Him, He gives you, He also honors you in the end. And this is why I've entitled this short sermon from the book of 1 Samuel chapter 2. That God declares this. Them that honor me, I will honor. Now I want you to underline that, friends. Them that honor me, I will honor. Now this is a promise that God has given us. And that when we honor Him, God has promised that He's going
to.
Now these four young men, they wanted nothing and no corruption would be brought before them. And that in all us, whatever is good, they will
go before
God. And they chose that they wanted to be the true representatives of the kingdom that they know. Now, really, did they know the test that was coming? But one thing that is for sure, whatever principles that they had laid and learned from their humble homes, they did not want to compromise. Now, verse 8 says this. After their names have been changed. Now, you can imagine somebody having to change your name. Because I've got a hidden agenda. And you know, in the modern days, the Hebrew parents, when they give somebody a child a name, they attach so much importance to that name. And I don't know how they felt that actually they're being given these strange names.
And
the Bible does not record that they protested. They accepted in humility. But what they knew inside their hearts, that they are this me, I am Daniel. I will never change.
Anyway,
no matter that you come and give me
any,
I will never change. Because the laws of God are written in my heart. It is not by giving me a new name that I'll start acting differently and compromise the things of this
world.
They accepted these things, friends. And we don't see any rebellion. Verse 8 says, but Daniel resolves not to deform himself. Now, this is after that the first test that came. That the king says, and he gave a command, the instruction, that the men that you have chosen for training, I want you to treat them in a very special way. In terms of the food that they eat, the water that they drink, the education that you give them, the language that they need to speak, I want you to dedicate all resources. But Daniel resolved not to defile himself with the royal food and wine. Now, you may ask yourself, where did this all come from? The king had ordered the official that
give
them all the best things that you have. And don't say anything. And do everything at your disposal to ensure that you get the best
graduates.
Now, I just want you to think for a minute. You are in a certain run. You are in captivity. You have been captured. You are far away from your home and your parents. There are no relatives. You don't have
anyone.
And the resistance that has come.
The
Bible says that the food that should be eaten is that food that has been saved from the table of the king. Now, that first test, friend, the first test, if they had compromised the first test, that would have meant that for the rest of their lives in Babylon. There is no excuse that they are going to give. That there are a lot of Christians, those Adventists, those who understand the
principle
of God. They know about the fourth commandment of God. And that when they start looking for a job, the fact that they never disclose to their employer that they are sending their Adventists, which compels them to honor the seventh day week of the Lord. And when the first test comes, they are given the opportunity that they should welcome that. Then they find that actually they cannot overcome this test. But from the very beginning, with this young man, the Bible says Daniel resolved not to defy himself in the royal food and wine. That we want to defend the truth that we know, but we die inside without mentioning anything. But it is only when the test that comes, that's when we find out that actually we cannot withstand the test. Verse 10 says, but the official told Daniel, I am afraid of my lord the king, who has assigned your food and drink. Why should we see you looking worse than the other young man, your age? The king would then have my head because of you. And look at the response in verse 11. Daniel then said to the guard who the chief official appointed by Daniel, the official that was responsible for this four young men, he responds in verse 12. Please test your servants for 10 days. Give us nothing but vegetables to eat and to water to drink and water to drink. And he went on to even ask that after that, I want you to wear us and compare us to the rest. Now, the first friend that we should not forget here, there are two things that we need to learn about this
day.
The food that was being given to this four young men, it is the and then they want to eat this, people want us to eat this food that is so the first dimension of this saved friends was the fact that they did not want to partake or to be part of see worshiping idols. You know the first thing that you have is to understand how is this test going to affect me. Now when you read the spiritual prophecies, he says the fact that they did not even want to compromise, not even to test. It is because anything, if you take a small thing to test, you compromise the test. You compromise your principles. You know the fact that most of us have found ourselves in various circumstances. That we find ourselves in situations where we cannot stand some of these things. You know, I remember it was 1999. I sent a friend to visit his relatives far away in the countryside. We traveled for about 5 hours on a bicycle. And then we left the bicycles, we got to a port. And then we crossed, it took us an hour in the boat to reach the other side of the road. And we reached that village, friends. And all the people in the villages, they came to welcome us. Because my friend has never been to that village for almost 10 years. Now, the only thing that people would come to entertain us with was alcohol in a calabash. And they came and sat around us. And I'm saying this was in 1998. And I was baptized in 1985. Now, what happened was that when the circle, the caravan started going through the circle, I was sitting at the far end. And my friend was not an Adventist. Then I looked at his face. How was he going to react when now the caravan reaches his face? And the fact that the caravan was going clockwise, and the fact that he was on my right hand side, meaning that he was the one with the first person. I'm going to see how he is going to treat the calabash. Before I can also do this, I can do this. Now the fact was that should I test and then refuse to tell them that no, I don't partake of alcohol. Now these are elders in the village, all of them. And all of them, everybody were praising how sweet and how strong this liquor was. Now I looked at my friend working the calabash. And they asked him to shake it very nicely. And I saw him putting the calabash on his mouth. And I wanted to see the muscles from this mouth. Is it moving? And then I saw that they were not moving. And passed on to the next man. And then he wiped his lips like this. I know I was going to do the same thing as well. And then when he reached my position, I did the same. And then I held it. And I put it on my mouth. I also closed my lips very tight, pretending that I'm drinking. And I also passed it around. weeping. I said, these were men with principles like of sin. Those who wanted to stand for the kingdom of God. You know, the Bible has said a lot of things about this young
man.
Now, I don't want to go into details. I'm just focusing on chapter 1. You know this young man, friend?
Yes.
I want you to imagine with me. These are men. Young men. Who came from humble homes. That these simple homes, but they've been taught by parents. And to take to the royal palaces. You know, if there were other young men of today, you forget about your humble home. You forget about everything. You forget about everything. And the fact that when you look at it, you understand and appreciate the training that this young man
received.
And they said that in whether in prosperity or in adversity, we are going to honor God. And that the fact remains. Where we come from, we know that there is one Jehovah. And this is why we cannot compromise on
that.
Now, verse 15 says, at the end of the 10 days, they looked healthier and better nourished than any of the young men who ate the royal food. Friends, I'm not preaching about health reform.
No.
But I want to preach, and I'm mentioning this morning, the principles of
the
The principles that are enshrined in us, the things that our parents are training us, are we neglecting those principles? When we are faced with challenges, when the world throws so many troubles and challenges at us, how do we respond to these issues? Are we responding that the young men of Judah, the four Hebrew boys, those who came up front, they declared that we only know one God? Now, the fact that these people were captives in Babylon, you know, they knew that, look, all those vessels that were captured from Judah, they had been placed in the temple in Babylon. And the whole Babylon was worshipping these idols. And for that matter, actually, it meant that the Babylonians were seen to have a superior religion than these young boys. But this did not bother them. Because they said, no matter who comes from humble homes, with the something that we can show the people of Babylon, that we know that there is one Jehovah. We know that there is one Redeemer. And that is Jehovah God, who created the heavens and the earth. And that we want to demonstrate His holiness. And that we want to show the true obedience that God
requires.
And that through obedience, God will honor those who honor
Him.
He honored those who
honored
Him. Now, from the humble homes where they came from,
to
the royal palaces now where they have been trained, they knew that they couldn't look back. But they would look forward, knowing that the God
that
they trust, He will come to their rescue. And this is why when you read further in chapter 3, you find that the ways that came from the three Hebrew boys now, besides Daniel, I want you to note something here. In chapter 1, the Bible does not mention anything that came from the three other boys. Demonstrated that all the four of them, they understood who their God is. Because Daniel in chapter 1, he puts his position very clear. And we find that this position was not different from the position of these other three people. And that when you look at all what happened, that God was at work for those he knew that were abandoning him. You know that just the process of prosperity, to live in the royal palace, and then by the end of 3 years, you know, friends, when you read this passage from Haggai, you may think that these poor young boys were foolish. But I think that the Bible goes to explain and to demonstrate that God was on the side of this young man. Now, this morning, when I think about this passage, I ask myself, how do I react to these issues? When it challenges, when the world throws all these things at me, all the tests that are there, when I know I can do anything that I want to do, am I representing God the way God wants to be represented? And I want you also to know something here. We don't see anywhere where God opened his mouth to speak to Daniel. Although we find that Daniel, he started having this explaining and giving him meaning. I want to believe, friends, that this relationship that converted or that came out, that emerged, it is as a result that God saw the obedience from this Now, you may also say that how come that the king did not object to the suggestion that Daniel was given? You know Daniel come with this suggestion, friend. He says, your majesty, then why don't you just rest us on vegetable and water only? You know, sometimes we're compelled to do things that don't even make any suggestions. Because we are scared and we are worried about how the world is going to look at us. You know, just by the fact that they were given even these names, new names, the king had hoped that slowly but surely these boys would start understanding the meaning of these new names. And and start being converted into
idolatry.
And as the king expected that they would be slowly being used
to
follow the religion of Babylon. But despite all these changes to this
world,
Daniel and his friends said, look, you can change our names. But we're not
going to
compromise. Now, I said that the taste for this food, friends, is at two dimensions. The first one is that they didn't want to involve themselves in worshiping
idols.
As the food was also being offered to
these idols.
And also the fact that they knew they were still under training. They didn't want to compromise their mental faculties. That's the second dimension of this. That's the second dimension of this test that came. Now we find that they came out victorious. And that in loyalty to Jehovah, God started blessing Daniel and his friends. And that the fact that they did not even pretend and they dared not to risk anything that they had seen the bigger picture. You know the song that I said that I like very much? That I said, I'm so glad I learned to trust in thee. That precious Jesus as a savior and as a friend.
Yes, when I'm seeing this.
Meaning that Jesus becomes a savior. Every time that you're in trouble,
he
becomes a savior. And that when I'm lonely, as they were in captivity, Jesus became to be a constant friend. And that their soul was about the savior and that Jesus led
them.
And that Daniel and friends, they trained by their parents. Their habits and strict obedience and also to be temperate in all things. And that God would hold them accountable someday. You know the way we're doing things these days. We find ourselves doing all sorts of things without knowing that there will be a day that will
come
around. A day is coming, friends, when we are going to account for every action that we do. Now, when we look at the education that Daniel and his friends received, it was meant to present them for the world yet to come. The king had something for them, which he had planned, and he wanted to give them positions. But we see that despite them not partaking of all these things, showed to honor God. No matter how strong these temptations were, no matter how dangerous the place where they were, what's going on. You can have so many excuses to give. You know, to be far away from your families. To be far away from your parents. You may have so many excuses. But that would make you compromise. You know, I imagine that Dan was his friends. You know, there would have been very various reasons and excuses to make. That you know what, we're in a foreign land. There is no Paris to be seeing us. There are no other Hebrews who are looking at us. We are all in here. So why don't we just do what the king wants us to do? If we taste this food, we watch it. But I want to believe that they knew that it was God in them. Who was watching and see what was happening. And that they wanted to remain adhered to the divine principle and not to offend God. And that should then disregard the commandment of the Lord and win the favor in front of the king. This was just for a short brief moment. Now, friends, we are here. We know we are strangers in this world. So, whatever that we do, whatever makes us happy, it's one day come to an end here. And I want us to know this, that in times of trouble, in terms of challenges, let us learn to seek God. And we seek what God approves. You know, the approval of what God desires is what becomes critical and important to us. And the way Daniel was determined to make his end, there is no surprise for us to name how God blessed him. And what Daniel resolved in the first chapter, he was supported by other friends. Now, in terms of standing firm, they came to understand that you do not have to give in even to a small talk of anything. Immediately you give it to the small text, then everything else is wicked. They knew that they would enjoy life, they would enjoy scholarship, they would receive all what they want. And that the first wrong step would lead to others' wrong steps. Until their connection with heaven was destroyed, they would be swept away into temptation. And that's why it's so critical for us, friends. God is going to honor us because we have fallen. Now, before I close, I want us to go to Daniel chapter 12, verse 18. That is the last verse. Now, I want you to link this verse to the song that we opened the service with. That is so sweet to trust in Jesus. And the composer of the song says that I am so glad that I learned to trust thee. Precious Jesus, save a friend. And I know that thou art with me. Will be with me till the end. And when we read Daniel chapter 12, friends, Daniel chapter 12, verse 13. I may read from verse 9 so that we have the good context of this.
Who
verse 9 says, he replied, go your way, Daniel, because the words are rolled up and sealed until the time of the end. Many will be purified, made spotless and refined, but the wicked will continue to be wicked. None of the wicked will understand, but those who are wise will understand. And then I want a jump to verse 13. Verse 13 says, as for you, go your way till the end. You will rest. And then at the end of the days, you will rise to receive your allotted inheritance. Friends, if there be any verse that I have cherished in this, in the Word of God, this is one of the verses that it tells me that all what Daniel and his friends achieved in Babylon, it may be seen that God will remember them at the end of time. And this is why the composer of the song, he's saying, it is, I'm so glad that they trust me, because I know you want to only be with me now, but you will also be with me till the end. And for Daniel, this promise was fulfilled. That for those who haven't followed the book of Daniel, I want you to take time, friends, to read this chapter 1. You take it through to chapter 2, chapter 3. Until you finish to chapter 12. Understanding how the Hebrew bonds became a blessing. That even the king, he came to appreciate the presence of these four Hebrew boys in this kingdom. Now the question that I want to leave with you this morning, are you going to remain that true representative of God your Jehovah, the one you have known, the one who has led you all the way, all the way the Savior leads me, why to dance beside his tender mercies, that is from the time when I became a Christian, God has been with you. You have received this teaching and you understand what God expects you. What are you going to tell me when that test comes before you? It is my prayer, friends, that let us demonstrate that we are representative of the heavenly kingdom. That let us not even negotiate to be tested and compromise in one's
mind.
Compromise in one small thing. Let us dishonor God. And if we don't honor God,
He's
not going to honor us. 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse
30.
God is declared. He says, they that honor me, I will honor. And this is a promise. And that promise remains standing for you and I to claim this promise. Let us claim this promise, friends.
And
through Jesus Christ,
Jesus Christ.
Amen.